What a cool gadget. Now, several days ago, a line of very violent thunderstorms came through the East Coast and knocked out power for about 3 million people. Now, it's about 5 days later, and a million still don't have power. Now, the morning after the lights went out, I'm in my car listening to the radio to get an impact, not this. And there were several people complaining that it was all the TV's fault because they weren't warned in advance to charge up their cell phones and fill up their tanks with gas and run out and get food and water. And all I could think was, oh my God, there's an awful lot of people who are not prepared for even the smallest of natural disasters. And there seems to be a bunch of people out there who don't even have it in their head that they should. In an attempt to help, here's a list of things you can do to prepare for a natural disaster. Now, if the power's out for a couple of days, you probably still need to go to work. This isn't going to happen if you're out of gas. You need to get in the habit, if you're not already there, to when you hit a half a tank, to fill up. Because you may have to live in that half a tank for a couple of days. Now, once the gas station gets electricity back, it'll be able to pump gas, the pumps getting the gasoline out of the ground into your car works, but your credit card may not work. Why is that? That's because that credit card machine doesn't know anything. When you swipe your card, it has to communicate over the internet or phone lines to get to some server farm far away. And if the power is out anywhere in the path to include that server farm, your machine doesn't know what to do. You're not going to be able to buy anything. You have to have cash on hand. How much depends on the person and the situation. Enough to get you by a couple of days. $100, $200, take it, stick it in an envelope. Write on it something like disaster fund and stick it in a pile with your other things that you need in case there's the power outage. Water has to be part of your disaster kit, whether it's a brick of these little bottles or a couple of these. You gotta have water on hand. Plan for at least a week. Now, you can mix it up with soda. You can also buy things like this, Weiler's Light. They're little individual packages. These are pretty cool because these are portioned to match something like this. Pour it in, and I have iced tea. Non-perishable food is critically important for your disaster planning. Because after about a day without power, your food in your refrigerator and your freezer are going to start to spoil. Now, when you buy cans, you need to buy in single serving sizes, because once you open it up, you're not going to be able to preserve it. You're going to have to eat the whole thing. Also, any cans you buy should have pull top lids in case you can't find a can opener. Now, I like to start my planning with soup. You can use something like your condensed chicken noodle soup, Campbell's, love Campbell's. But you have to add water. So, unless you like eating this concentrated, might not be the best choice. A better choice is probably something like Chunky or Progresso. You've got the pull top and it's a ready-to-go meal. In general, you want to have some canned fruits and vegetables. How about some canned meat like tuna fish? Perhaps Spam, only buy what you like. Now for breads, could be crackers, Triscuits, Pop-Tarts. You want enough for about 21 meals. Take it all, put it in a corner, label it your disaster food. Now, this preserved food only lasts so long, so you want to swap it out. Here's an extra idea. Once a year, pick a date, Thanksgiving, your birthday, take it all, give it to the food bank. You can take that as a tax deduction, and then go out and buy a whole new set for the next year. Now, if you don't know where a food bank is, start your search at the local public library. All the ones I've been to have a box that you can donate to. No power means you need lights at night. Now, what does everybody tell you? Have a flashlight. Now, the problem with a flashlight is when you need it, it seems like the battery's dead. That's always been my case. Now, what has worked for me are these ornamental lights that you stick out in the front yard. I personally find the quantity of 6 very good. Now, all you have to do is take off the top, and you've got a candle. They're always charged because they're in the sunlight every day. And I scatter them around the house. Say, bathroom, kitchen, hallway, bedroom. And then at the end of the evening, you can just turn them off. Most of them have a little on-off switch. The next day, you can stick it back outside to ensure it is charged and bring it at night, and you have light indefinitely. Now, if you want to use candles, I suggest tea candles. They're very inexpensive. You can buy a bag at the dollar store. They're portioned to last just a couple hours, which is pretty much what you want, and they're designed not to spill the wax. Now, candles are a fire hazard, especially if you have pets and small children. They could get knocked over and you could have a catastrophe on your hands. I like the idea of getting these artsy candle holders, placing them on the walls in strategic places. Decorate your house, tea candles in there. Someday if you need it, you're already set to go. You can find these anywhere from Pier 1 to Target. Now, something people often forget about is information. If you have to flee your house, and now you find yourself in a refugee camp like my sister did after Katrina, you have to have a way of contacting people to let them know that you're still alive. And quite often, especially nowadays with cell phones, you don't know people's telephone numbers. You don't remember their addresses. Okay, so you need some sort of contact list. It can be in a paper form. Now, as my sister discovered, if you're being evacuated, you can't bring anything with you, no bags. So digitizing your life and putting it on a thumb drive that you can stick in your pocket may be the only thing you can take with you. Even something like this may be too big. Now, digitizing your life is really important. You may have a disaster like forest fire or floods or tornadoes, something that you're going to escape. You want to digitize your life. This is a mini hard drive. It's about a half a gig. The sort of things that you want to put on this would be, for example, your contact list, digitized photos, perhaps tax information, list of all the websites that you like and all the ones that you need, say banking information, stocks. You want logins and passwords. Now, if you're going to have the really sensitive stuff on something like a thumb drive or a little mini hard drive, you probably want to use some sort of public encryption. If somebody gets their hands on it, you don't want them stealing all of your stuff. If you have a digital camera and tripod, you can digitize photos and documents. Cell phones are great, but what if the battery dies? Now, here's an interesting idea. Casio has something called GeForce Watch. It's a data bank. It's waterproof, and you can put telephone numbers in it. This has come in real handy when I found myself suddenly out of touch or overseas and it didn't make sense to take my cell phone with me. Where I live, the worst that I ever experience about once a year is a power outage. Now, if you live somewhere where wildfires are common, earthquakes, tornadoes, hurricanes, floods, then you may be in a situation where every year, a couple years, you have to get out of town pretty quick. You got an hour or two. Now, this would be a case where you want to have a flyaway kit. Well, this can be any kind of small bag, a backpack. That's where you would put the stuff we've already talked about in it, you know, such as your information and your money and your contact list. But you also want to have in there a change of clothing. Even one change can make a world of difference. You also want to have toiletries. you know, shaving, toothbrush, the sort of things that you need every day. In the wintertime, you're probably going to need heat. Fire logs are very convenient, and you can buy them in logs that'll last up to 5 hours. Now, when it comes to cooking, if you don't have a grill and you have to have some sort of little fire, bonfire, or something in a fire pit, a supply of these little starters come in handy. You can break them in half. A box like this didn't cost very much at all. It had 24. That's a potential large number of meals that you could cook. And there we have it. If you fulfill that list, you'll be in great shape. And don't forget the pets. They have needs also.